joined the army 42. First day. Walking into the armory was Avenue Road in Toronto, and it's Avenue Road. So I wanted to join up the army. Okay. And they were forming a new battery with 117 field battery RCA. And they were just recruiting for it. Got it all recruited. And then I guess it'd be the close to the end of July, last week of July or so, when they hadn't gotten in, they took us off to Petawawa. And we were training there until middle October. And it got darn chilly, because we lived in tents. So then they moved to Dr. Pervert. And that's where I met Francis. We got down there, then they started calling on our outfit to supply reinforcements. So some of the guys got drafted for overseas out of it. And that's why we had this going away thing at the IOD, and this guy got married. But it started out as a going away party for the guys that were leaving. Sitting there, four or five of us, and these three girls walked in. So I said to the guy next to me, I said, "See that one tom in there with the burgundy dress with the white spots on it?" "Yeah." I said, "I have to go over and meet her. That's the one I'm going to marry, so I might as well meet her." And I did. I remember I was going overseas. I used to go home every night, girl. So got word, nobody leaves camp. Not everybody's confined to barracks, but leaving tomorrow morning. So I said, "Look, I'd like to call and tell my wife I'm not going to be in. Can't do that. I get out, my wife's not stupid. If I don't turn up tonight, or if I don't call her, she knows right there. She's not stupid. No call." "Okay." So, next one we take off, pull into Truro, the rail yard, between two freight trains, and we pull in. Pulls in between. I look out the window, and there's Francie. So I get up. The MPs come along, back on the train. So I want to say goodbye to my wife. So anyway, I finally got back on the train and we take off. Get to Halifax on the boat. Then they nail me. Call me up with the intelligence. "If this was a tragedy, who the hell was this?" "So, want to know, how come your wife knew?" I said, "Well, I told the night before, my wife was not stupid. I said, I wanted to call her and tell her, well, I can't get home tonight. I'm going to have to stay here. But I'll see, you know. If I don't call, she's not stupid. She knows right off the bat something's up." Now, Truro is a railroad town. 50% of the people living there working the railroad. She's only got to go to her neighbor and say, "Ain't troop trains coming through today?" Next thing you know, they'll tell her when troop trains coming through, they'll tell her at the same time and where it's going to stop and what track. They'll know. So, she found out. She was there. Say goodbye. They didn't do anything. They said, "Okay." We pulled out of Halifax and went south to around Cuba or someplace and took over across the Atlantic to the Azores and then up the coast, and says, "We're sitting out there in our underwear. You go summer uniforms, we crossed in November in the cold. But was nice and warm down where we were. But coming back, I came back at the end of January. It was about a 6-day crossing. It took us 10 days. Rough, all miserable weather. I loved it. I wasn't sick at all. The rougher it got, the better I liked it. And the more I got, the more I could have to eat because too many people weren't eating. In fact, if I had known I liked it that much, I'd have probably joined the Navy. But I was afraid, coming from Toronto, I was afraid to join the Navy. I just didn't know about this seasick business, you know. And I didn't want to join the Air Force. So I thought, I'll go in the Army. And Milner went to the Navy. Jack and Harry were the Air Force right from the beginning. Right from, well, day one. Harry was a pilot, a fighter instructor. And then he transferred to bomber training because he wanted to get overseas. They made him a bomber instructor. So he never did get there. And Jack never got there, and Milner never got out of that. I was the only one that got anywhere. And Jack was married at the time, two young kids. So Earl and two kids moved in with us. We didn't have a very big house, but Jack's 10 years older, Milner was 9, Harry was 7. But between Harry and I, there were twins. But the twins died in 1920, when I had a big flu epidemic here in the country, in Canada, the United States. A lot of people died that time. So the twins died in that. And I was born in 21, I think they were born in 18, they were around 2 or 3. That's Francis' brother Ralph I met over there. I met him in Rotterdam. I had been out over to in a park, and they had like a dance hall. And so just everything, a building with everything going on, you know. And it started to rain. I figured I'm gonna scoot through here, across the park, and our unit was just stationed to the other side. So I'm jogging down the path there, and I hear this guy holler, "Gord, hey, who knows me here?" So in a way, I stop and look around, and there's this guy standing in a tent, and it's Ralph. So I go over and talk to Ralph. Gee whiz, surprised to see him, because he had been down in Italy too. He was with Fifth Field. But he got lost from his unit. He'd just get out of the hospital. Didn't know where his unit was. You know, okay, you can go out, but where's he gonna go? So he wanders through the park and he sees this tent, it's raining, so he goes in. So in a way, I said, "Well, no sense you staying here, Ralph, come with me." So we both jog over to our unit. And of course he's got nothing. He pulls on his back and that's what he's got. So, we find out where his unit is, and they're only about 50-60 miles in the Holland from where we were. So, okay, well, you spend the night with us. So in a way, I got him, his uniform was messy and dirty. So I got him a new uniform. I got him, oh, I guess 2 or 3 cartons of cigarettes and a couple of bottles of scotch. Got fed well, and some extra underwear and extra socks, pretty well fixed up, and then the next morning I got him a lift to his unit. I went with intelligence in February 45, and I was with headquarters intelligence on the continent until March, sometime in March. They sent enough staff in, like keep the unit up to 13. But then they would send in 3 or 4 other fellows, well, every 3 or 4 days. Take them out, send 3 or 4 more in. Just so they would, could say they'd been to Berlin. But they were with intelligence, but never with first day. They might have been with the 2nd, 3rd, or 4th, or something like that, and just sent in, or they might have been with headquarters, I don't remember. But they weren't like part of the unit. That was the OC, that plane. He was the sergeant major, and the rest of us were all sergeants. Smith, well, he was the senior sergeant. He took over when Bob came back from OC. Bob didn't go to Berlin. Now that's Fontaine. He came to us like after. He was quite a guy. He was from Saskatchewan. He was a Mountie before the war. Spoke English. But wherever he went, he listened for a few minutes and he could talk to me. And it didn't matter what language it was, we read Russian, so he was able to talk. Amazing. Never saw a guy like that in my life. He conversed with me. It was just a matter of listening to him for a few minutes and then he was in conversation with me. It didn't matter whether we were in Holland or in Germany, it didn't matter.
That's a German staff car. I really don't know how we got our hands on it.
I don't remember. But either way, it was a Mercedes-Benz Arbor proof and everything. Watson, now he was from New Toronto, same as I was. They're all Canadians, basically, but there was a fellow who wasn't. He was transferred to us later by the name of Paul Pell, and he was German. His family got out of Germany when Hitler came in, and when we were there, he got a letter from his mother asking her to go to such an address, which was the last address she had of her sister. So would he go and see if, you know, they're still there, if she's living or what? And I went with him. He met his aunt. The place was still there. It was bombed out pretty well, but they were still able to live in it. And while we were there, he saw this picture of a guy in SS uniform sitting on an end table or something. So he asked his aunt who that was. Oh, that's your cousin so-and-so. Well, how do you make out? Is he all right? Oh yeah, he's just out for a while. He should be back in a few minutes. Mm-hmm. So when he came in, well, they'll put him under arrest. SS guys were automatic arrest, eh? And then Vic, he was quite a character. I guess I was working with him more than the other. We must have been assigned together, I suppose. Because I seemed to be with him most of the time. And yet when Sid Lamb needed help, he was always needing one. Of course, he would line up these things, eh? He would seem to be out looking for it. And he thought he'd turn a dollar on. Well, he and I were on duty one day, driving down through the city, trying to buy some tennis courts. So, gee, it'd be nice if we could get a game of tennis. I used to be a pretty good player. They said, yeah, so did I. So now, two or three days later, we decided, well, okay, let's go play tennis. So we did. It doesn't matter who won, but it was a lot of fun. We played two out of three sets, and it was in summer, it was in August, and it was warm. Anyway, we came off the tennis court, and this German guy sitting over there, he's an old fellow, and I guess he must have been 35 in a way. And he had a beautiful watch, which Germans didn't wear. And he's sitting there, we come off, perfect English. He says, would you fellas like to have a game with me? Oh no, we're kind of tired now. We just played three sets. Oh, he says, I understand, but I thought I would bet my watch against a couple of cartons of cigarettes. And I understand you're tired, he says, but look, I'll play you fellas into the single court, and you can play me into the doubles. Oh. I said, oh, Vic, we got a pigeon, let's go. Let's get this guy right now. And Vic says, well, who gets the watch? I said, who cares? Let's get it first and worry about what we do with it after. So we get up there in the court, you want a little volley first, he said? Oh, no, let's go. Let's go. You want to serve first, or will I serve? No, you go ahead. You serve first. So you're going to serve to me first. Well, I'm still standing there waiting to see that ball. I can't even move. Yeah. So he crosses over the court and he serves to Vic, and Vic don't move. So we serve to him. We don't receive the volley coming back. Oh, he was good. We played one set. We didn't take a point. It was all over the way. We gave us two cartons of cigarettes. And he said, I don't know if you fellas ever heard of me or not. He's, my name is Ernest Montrown. He was these guys today, you know, these big Davis Cup back in the 30s, eh? So that pretty well wound that up. Yeah, that was Lieutenant Cole. When he was sent to us, he brought his wife with him. Now, his wife was Dutch. So he must have got married after the war in Holland to this Dutch girl who lived in Amsterdam. And you weren't allowed to take people to different countries. Anyway, he did. He brought his wife in. And it must have been someone in head office, headquarters, must have found out about it. And he got a notice about 2 o'clock in the morning that someone, a certain name, would be flying into Tempelhof and would like to be met and to interview Lieutenant Cole. Right off the bat, he knew he was in trouble. This guy was coming for that purpose. You know, he didn't say anything about it, but he just guessed this is what it was. So he's got to get her out of there. And we had already smuggled people in and out, so he knew who he could get to do it. So he called me and said, Lamb, woke us up. What was the situation? And would we get his wife, the devil, out of there right now and get moving to Holland? Well, sure, but you got to make sure, Lieutenant, there is nothing left behind. You know, make sure there's not a bra hanging here or there's hanging there. Get everything, make sure everything is cleaned out. So anyway, she gets up, she gets dressed, she's ready. We get the 1500 weight ready. Put a mattress up near the cab, load the back end up with jerry cans and spare tires and whatnot. And then we take off. We get her in to Holland. After we leave Berlin, we get into East Germany, still in the Russian zone until you come to, I forget the old place, but it's good, probably 100 kilometers from Berlin. And once we got out of their inspection points, and I drove into Amsterdam, and then we drove back into Berlin. But we took some guy who was, he was German, and we only took him into West Germany. But he said that if we would do that, take him into West Germany, he was a former photographer or something, a folk of business. And in his backyard in West Germany, he had buried thousands of dollars or marks or whatever it was worth of cameras. And sure enough, he had all that stuff buried there. We helped him dig it out. We got it, loaded it into the truck. Tell him, okay now, I want a Zeiss Zycon, and Gordon wants a Zeiss Zycon. So I got my Zeiss Zycon, so did Sid, and we got him back into Berlin and delivered him to wherever we wanted to go with his goodies. Beautiful cameras, they really were. They were 35 millimeter. In those days, German cameras were the ultimate. I traded mine off for a Leica 35 millimeter that had telephoto lens and everything else with it. The Zeiss Zycon was just an ordinary 35 millimeter. The ultimate was to have a Luger. I never did that one. But anyway, this guy got one. He's going to get it home. So he took it all apart. And over a period of a month or so, every two or three days, he sent a part home. And finally, he got the whole gun home. And his wife says, "That's a nice thing." She takes it out. She has a gunsmith put it all together for him. It's all nice. And then she sent it back. She thought he couldn't put it together. And he gave the Luger away. That was the end of that. And he gave that away. But a lot of guys, I think, did try to smuggle them back. They'd probably get away with it. Yeah. But I wouldn't try it. I figured it was just my luck to get caught. You wouldn't even get off the boat, you know. You stay on and you go back. Someplace in Holland, I remember we went up from, we're going to move up further to the front. And the OC and I went up. We found a place to move the unit into. And we're on our way back. Boom. Snipers. Right between us in the Jeep. He says, the OC said, "Well, this was funny." Of course, he'd been all through action, right? Mm-hmm. He knew what it was all about. He says, "No." He says, "We were good soldiers. We would stop. Get that guy." I said, "I'll stop and let you out." So, we ducked down and swerved around a corner, put some building between he and I. He says, "Oh," he says, "he was aiming for me." I said, "No, Andy, he wasn't aiming for you. He was aiming for me. If he gets me, he's got you. If he gets you, I'm not. No, I'm still living. I'll take this Jeep out of here. If he gets me, he's going to get you." That's in the Russian song. If you're out there till after dark, and then you weren't allowed in. And if you were, you got picked up. And that gate, you had an opening. An army truck would have to really go very slow. I think the pillars were about 3 feet wide and 10 feet long, and it was solid cement or brick or something. But the Jeep, you could go pretty fast as long as you do exterior carefully.
Yeah.
Which I did. I got caught once. If it hadn't been for that stupid, it was an airman. Well, he was still intelligent, but he was an airman. And we got nailed. So I figured, well, maybe we would talk our way out of it. And that silly nut. He says, you can't do this to us. He says, we're intelligence. Oh, gee. No, we spent the night in jail. We spent it answering questions and everything else. Finally, they decided we didn't know too much, I guess, so they let us go. Oh, my God, though, what a thing to say. We might have talked our way out of it, you know. You can't do that to us. We're intelligence. Oh, gee. And that is about it. Summed up 4 years pretty quick, didn't it? But what is there to sum up? I'm glad I went through it. Oh, yeah, definitely. Looking back, I would hate to think that it happened at my time and I didn't get there. You know, I'm sorry it happened and all that. I wish it hadn't happened. But seeing that it did, I'm glad I got there. For one reason, and that's where I met Francis. Yeah, I didn't forget her. I never met her. Things would be a heck of a lot different, wouldn't they?
Thank you.